Chance Encounters, Season 2. Here we go. Okay, spring. Where's James? Come on, James. We are interviewing the cast of Story of My Life, and we are interviewing Bette and Wylie Aitken. How could he have forgotten again? Oh, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to kill you. Kill. Nope. Come back. Don't you get in that bed. Oh!
It's a new day filled with possibilities, a chance encounter today. The chance to tell you all about my favorite things, musicals and plays. You wanna meet me outside, but I'm spending my time rehearsing 12 hours a day. I don't have stock options or a 401k, but there's nowhere that I'd rather stay than theater today. It's a new day filled with opportunities to play pretend on the stage. Hey, folks, wish we could hug.
Not today.
Hopefully someday. While there's sunshine outside, I'd rather spend all my time in darkness rehearsing my death, or something equally sad, repeating for hours, cue after cue. There's nothing that I'd rather do than theater with you. Than theater with you. Than theater with you. It's true, I love theater with you.
Welcome back! It's season 2 of Chance Encounters. I am your host, James Michael McHale, and this show is all about celebrating theater. New season, new set, same level of excellence. Each show, we celebrate our favorite theater traditions, interview artists from productions happening right now, and end each show, most importantly, with a classic monologue. Theater's fucking back, y'all! It's about goddamn time. I mean, I just can't fucking wait to get in there and just get all the place in, over the chairs, backstage together, just front of everybody. Today, I'm so excited to be talking with two amazing supporters of the arts, philanthropists Bette and Wylie Aitken, and the artists from the OC premiere of The Story of My Life. Happening now! But first, as always, let's start with two of my favorite theater traditions, sign-in, check-in.
You're good.
And now, check-in. This is one of my favorite theater games called Zip Zap Zop. We stand in a circle and I can zip to my right, where Amanda is, who then can either zap to her left, back to me, or zip to her right, to someone in the audience. Let's just try it. Let's not judge it. Let's try it. Okay. Here we go. Zip.
Zap.
Zip.
Zap.
Zip.
Zap.
Zip.
Zap.
Zip.
Zip.
Zap.
Zap.
It really takes a village, doesn't it, folks? And while I'm really looking forward to re-entering the world, having this time with Amanda and Meech makes me realize the other things that I'm actually gonna miss from this past year.
I'll miss you. Zoom meetings. The thrilling way I never knew if you and my internet connection would be with me or against me. The explanation of how to turn on your camera and unmute led to deep and detailed conversations with my parents many, many, many times. I'll miss the luxury of turning off my camera to hide my reaction of disdain for something said during a meeting, replanting my pleasant smile upon my return, and blaming my connection for the momentary disappearance. And while my boss goes into his 20th minute to explain something that could have been handled in a one-sentence email, how a trip to the bathroom could just be my little secret. Hope to see you around. I'll miss you. Mindless hours on Netflix. The way Bridgerton made me realize kinkiness doesn't have a timestamp. The way your search engine autofills the exact movie I am looking for, only to tell me it is not available and list 10 other options I'm not interested in that have a combined score of 15 on Rotten Tomatoes. No one wants to watch Angry Birds 2. And the delicate way you ask me if I am still watching, making me realize that not only have I lost a day of my life, but you have judgingly noticed. Hope to see you around. I'll miss you. Only getting half-dressed every day. The sweatpants and house socks that have been on my body for 4 days straight suddenly becoming apparent when the Amazon driver takes notice. Zippers and buttons are a horror I'm not ready to face, but I'm grateful for over a year of freedom for my waist and limbs and how you've made every day casual Friday. And the money I've saved on air conditioning, knowing my legs were free to find their natural temperature without the restraints of cloth, have allowed me to buy those 10 items featured on TikTok. Hope to see you around.
Since you brought it up, could you put your pants on?
You're actually here?
As I have told you each episode, this is not happening over Zoom.
Speaking of Zoom, let's get to today's first interview.
Hi, James.
Thank you all so much for joining me today. I'm so excited to get to talk to you about the story of my life. First show at the Chance in the 2021 season. Yeah. So let's dive in. You know, it's such a unique process. I would love to hear you talk about your approach to directing this show, because it's theater, but it's filmed, but it's still theater. So how do you go about doing that?
It is a strange and sort of unusual situation, and then also a very unexplored art form in general, because people haven't been forced into this situation before. So I think my approach was to try to embrace the benefits of doing things filmed, like what are the things that we can do on film that we can't do live stage, you know, and then try to make sure that those elements don't overpower or suppress any of the live stage immediacy that we like. And I think we accomplished that pretty well. And the end result is that we were basically filming on a green screen stage, but that we, as far as the actors were dealing with, it was all very much like a theatrical experience.
And what was it like to rehearse a musical remotely and then come together to film it? Because you all were rehearsing in your own homes, right? On Zoom, is that right?
Yeah, it was fascinating. It's a fascinating process. It was the strangest thing. Just what me and Dylan were able to do is just zoom in, focus on just our faces and just look at our faces. And of course, we weren't quite off book when we were in Zoom rehearsals. So I had like my script like here, but then Dylan's face was just there. And so it was like, they just kind of melded together.
I think that was the most important thing, was that the connection between us through Zoom was so important, and bringing that to the stage made it way easier to collaborate, you know, because we get to these deep places in the show. And so getting to those deep places over Zoom was extremely important, because we could bring those aspects to the stage in a way easier in a more comfortable setting.
So what is it like to stage a play when you're in, you know, little room like this with in your own homes?
Blocking was in a two-person musical with like two chairs, you know, the blocking became so secondary to just making sure that their connection was never broken and it was always justified by what their internal life was happening. So, you know, as opposed to like a big splashy musical where big choreographic numbers, etc., become so core to the identity of the show, in this one it was really about the relationship. So as long as that was intact, the show could proceed confidently.
Where it's like there are good things about the Zoom process, but then when you do get back into the space, it becomes abundantly clear why we do theater in person. Right? Like, it's just like when you're physically like in the character and in the body and the blocking, there's different choices that are made. A lot of that really great, like in-depth work was done before, but yeah, getting into the space, we were able to get into the space actually 2 days earlier than we thought we were going to. We did film the show in order for the most part, but there were some things where we'd have to go back. And so getting that flow was nice. So then both Dylan and Wynn were able to like kind of tap into like, hey, this is where I should be at this point if we do have to jump around.
And so like all of my like experience doing musicals in some ways, you know, some of it was useful, a lot of it wasn't, you know, and in the early process, because, you know, I just had to sort of predict or guess. So I felt like a beginner often, more in this process than in others. And learning as we go, you know, and team effort. I mean, I'm always that way with all my shows. I'm always team effort. But I think on this one, it was especially important.
For filming, we pre-recorded all of their vocals so that they had something to lip sync to be able to have a really clean and solid vocal so they weren't having to like recreate the same vocal performance every single time. And so my job was to operate that. Great to be back in the space. But it was just such a weird, like out of body experience. But at the same time, it still felt normal.
So you get to tell the story of two childhood best friends, right? From like early elementary school ages through to adulthood, right? And it's just the two of you, which is incredible. And you know, the show is just filled with so much beautiful music that just goes from funny to just very deeply moving, the whole gamut, which is just so exciting. But I would love to hear from you. What first grabbed you that made you go, I have to do this show?
Growing up, I didn't have like a big group of friends. I didn't have like a best friend. And so reading the scenes and reading the script and understanding it, I was drawn to that. Because I've never had that.
Like, so those musicals are kind of rare. The ones that you find that are super deep, that they have layers upon layers upon layers. And I'm just addicted to that kind of stuff. And I've never heard this musical before. And when I got called back for it, I was like, uh-oh, this is a great musical.
I was caught off guard by how much I felt connected to the characters, how much the story surprised me when it was going, weaving around, and it was hitting different places of in my life and in my experience, and it just felt so grounded.
It also, through the process, I did reflect a lot on relationships that I can't get back. And so the show reminded me of a friendship in particular, not necessarily to the same caliber of like what Thomas and Alvin go through, but just reminded me of like, I won't know what the last moments were like, kind of a similar thing.
A chance encounter is a fortuitous accident. So we end all our interviews with this question. What unexpected experience did you have working on the story of my life that is having a lasting impact on you?
I would, you know, I got to work with Wynn in this show, and You know, usually during live rehearsals and all that, you get to know somebody very well. But, you know, through Zoom rehearsals and all that, you know, I didn't really get to know Wynn as Wynn. I got to know Wynn as Alvin. And so we had a lunch break on Sunday, and literally the last day of filming. And it was just me and Wynn, we decided to go to Chipotle, get food. And then we just sat and talked for like an hour. And it was so like enjoyable because I got to know Wynn and not just Wynn as Alvin. I got to know Wynn. And I wish we had more time to do that.
There really was that. Like, it was the chance encounter. It was, we were fully prepared to just leave the experience as just kind of like a shake of the hand, feeling like we did our job and we're two professional actors and we were happy with our performance. Our words, you know? But like the takes that we had after that, I wish we had a whole other day.
But in editing, we're really favoring the Sunday takes. And Wynn and Dylan were both talking about how connected they finally got to be a bit on Sunday at lunch because they had finally time together to get to know each other as people. And that could be contributing to the reason why the Sunday takes were the winners. Us as individuals, us as characters, you know, and understanding each other just as we understand the story we're telling. So mm-hmm. I think it all fed into the video that we're making and the reason why the Sunday takes are dominant. But I have never done a show where I didn't hug my cast. Like, this, it was a very strange, it's kind of a downer, but like, we were very strict with our rules of distancing and what we could and couldn't do. And those rules were laid out and we followed them, you know, and I'm glad that we did and we were right to. But literally, it was the strangest thing. Like, I saw them on the Wednesday for the first time and I was like, hi guys, you know, and it was like, I was in like a bubble, you know, over here, nice to meet you, you know, kind of a thing. And then even on filming days, like I had to keep my distance and like not be around them. And then also as we were leaving, it was like, congratulations, great job, bye. You know, it just felt very, alone in ways that I wasn't prepared for. Mm-hmm. And it makes me value, like, you know, when we can get back to it, you know, fully. Just, I didn't realize how important that was to me, to be in a room with people and being able to really be with them as an organic living individual, you know, as opposed to a function. And so that was really, I think, an important lesson from this for me as an artist. Years may come and go.
Wanna see it? The story of my life! Go to chancetheater.com/story. Then go to the calendar and select your date. Then stream, stream, stream. Backstage says it's a captivating 90 minutes. Humor, heartbreak, and musical pleasures. This is limited time, fool! Only available through June 6th. Go now!
Other ways you can engage with the Chance Theater online. Some good news, OC.
Hey, are you doing that voiceover?
James, I promise that I will let you know when I'm done, okay? Okay. Stage facts on TikTok.
Are you done?
James, I just said that I will promise to tell you when I am finished. Chance Theater's Speak Up program, one benefiting teens and the other for teens on the spectrum, are now accepting online applications for their theater programs offered entirely free of charge.
Sorry, did you say you're finished or you are Finnish? Are you from Finland?
James!
Here at Chance Encounters, we can't contain our excitement that shows are finally opening. It makes me think about one of my favorite parts of openings. Reviews! Now, sometimes reviews can be tough, but I think there are no bad reviews, only learning opportunities. In this new segment, artists will read their past reviews to help them grow. And to soften the blow, here is Terrible Reviews with Ukulele.
In a show about life, death, and everything in between, Karen O'Hanlon's performance in Middletown made me want to usher in death with great haste. Okay. James McHale's acting, however, was pure beauty. He made dying look like life, a life that I wanted to live in forever.
Monica Pena's singing in Dogfight brought new meaning to the term hidden key. She couldn't find a key if it was placed under a doormat with a sign on the door that said key under the mat with a giant arrow pointing down. James McHale, however, delivered songs with the dulcet tones of an angel.
In Tribes, Bruce Goodrich delivers an acting performance that is so wooden, even a carpenter with the skill of Jesus could not build a footstool with it. James McHale, however, showed me to my seat with such aplomb, it would make even the most experienced usher blush in embarrassment of having witnessed such excellence. He wasn't even in the f***ing show.
Wow. I think I learned a lot from that. Now let's get to the spotlight interview.
Here we are. We're outside. We're in person.
It's beautiful.
Beautiful.
Fantastic.
Vaccinated. Like, this is incredible.
You are, can I get a measurement?
Yeah, yeah.
You
I think we are 6 feet apart.
Okay,
yeah, yeah.
Check it out.
Yeah.
Last year, so going back a year ago.
Pandemic hits, right? And it totally shuts down theater, and the chance among many organizations have a lease and a staff of employees and, you know, all of this to support. And my understanding is that you two were the first call to the theater to say, what can we do to help? How can we keep the doors open? And you created the Make Them Hear You campaign, which was a donation campaign matching dollar for dollar. Thank you. Thank you so much.
No, thank you for all what you and the actors and the company have done. You know.
Well, you're incredible.
All we did is help a little bit.
And why are the arts so important to you personally?
Well, Betty and I have been arts people since we can remember being in high school. When I started my very short acting career. So we've just really been committed to the arts, and of course, it's all about Betty and the Chance Theater, Bette Wylie Aitken Theater Arts Center, and I'll let Betty tell that story because I'm sitting here next to her about the Chance Theater, totally, because of her.
She goes to buy plants, and she's driving back home. And she looks to her left and she sees this sign for this tiny little theater, the original theater. Why? Actually, I since learned that even wasn't the original theater.
And I turned around and went back and looked. Oh, it was so exciting. All I said was, there's a theater just down the street. We have a theater. And I noted that.
Then she got me involved and we started buying tickets.
Well, after that, everything was perfect in every way because we had a theater.
I love it.
The theater was lovely. They had to do a lot of work with it because it was new. Not new, but because it just was. So anyway, we were very proud to be part of this.
She had gotten me engaged and we started attending regularly. And I think we became season ticket holders. Betty had been very involved as I had been. I chaired the board at South Coast Rep. Betty was a board member at South Coast Rep. But we got so attracted to the quality of the productions and what was the magic that you and your group and Han and Casey and Erica and everyone had been able to create this magical world with the most limited of resources, but the greatest resource in the world, which is the talent of all of you. We have never introduced anyone to Chance Theater that didn't walk away saying, thank you for inviting us, thank you for introducing us to the Chance Theater. And frankly, I don't see it as generosity. I see it as an opportunity to for us to do something that makes us so happy. And gets it
makes us better for ourselves.
And we get more out of the Chance Theater than the Chance Theater has ever gotten from us. So.
Bette and Wylie are two people who find out what they're passionate about, and they support it 110%. And what they're passionate about is their family, about their community, and the arts. And we've been very lucky that they found us and that we found them. And speaking to their characters, just every time we try to thank them, they turn it right back on us and thank us. And seeing the way that they are together inspires me. And I basically want to be Bette and Wylie when I grow up.
So also last year, after the murder of George Floyd, there was, of course, a spotlight shined on the need for racial and social justice, but also a significant self-examination and change that was needed in many organizations and our society as a whole. And, you know, you heard that call and went to work to begin to answer it. And you created a professorship at Chapman University Fowler School of Law to support a faculty member whose teaching scholarship and service furthers the university's commitment to diversity and equity and inclusion and social justice. And in fact, Janine Young Kim has been selected as the inaugural Wylie A. Aitken Professor of Law, Race, and Social Justice.
A lot of credit to Matt Parlow, who is the dean at the Fowler School. And I think the university had to respond very strongly, both across the board as well as the law school. And it's a cause that Betty and I have also been very, very much involved in, is the whole issue of trying to make this a more just society. And that's hopefully what lawyers do, and particularly trial lawyers. So it was that kind of perfect marriage, and the timing could not be better. We have a long way to go. I know that the theater itself reacted, the company reacted. I know our commitment to diversity within our casting and everything else we do at Chance. We're not going to change anything unless we change all aspects of our life.
I'm Jim Doty. I'm here to just tell you a few things about Wylie and Bette Aitken and their importance to Chapman University. Of course, there's their philanthropy. We have the Aitken Arts Plaza. We have the Aitken Trial Courtroom. And most recently, we were very proud to announce the Wylie Aitken Professorship in Law, Race, and Social Justice. But that's just the philanthropy. I want to thank Wylie in particular for all he's done as a leader, particularly a leader of our Board of Trustees. I had the pleasure of working as president under Wylie, learning from him helping me do a better job than I otherwise would have done. And he's continued that with Daniele Strupa. In fact, he was at the transition of my leaving, going out into the sun, riding out into the sunset, and Daniele coming in. And I think that transition, as smooth as it was largely a result of Wylie's leadership. Before I end, Bette, thank you for all you've done. Thank you for attending all those social events and social obligations. You've been terrific. You two are Chapman superstars.
I would love to know, Bette, when did you first fall in love with theater?
Boy, I love theater. It was probably something that makes you feel better about yourself, particularly when you've got wonderful people that are behind you and you know that it's going to be good and it's going to be special.
We met when we were 17.
My parents, they were really nice. I mean, my parents were really nice, but because Wylie was a Catholic, that was an issue.
Uh-oh. Now we're getting into religion.
It's the truth.
Now we're going to move into politics.
Yeah, yeah. We're going to cover all the tough subjects.
My grandfather was the minister in the church.
Okay.
So this was a whole new topic for me.
Mm.
I didn't say anything about it, and my mom didn't notice, but we just started dating.
You've supported and been on the boards for many arts organizations, not just the Chance. You know, SCR, Segerstrom Center for the Arts, you know, the California Arts Council.
Yeah,
you know,
I shared that.
Right, exactly. So many. So, what led you to get involved, to get re-involved with the arts at that level?
You know, we were so committed to really pay back the people that were entertaining us, making, I think, tremendous sacrifices. And we were always the people on the board that were reviewed as the ones that were so actor-oriented. We had set up a fund for acting salaries at South Coast Rep because I always said, if I'm going to give money, I'd like to see it go to those people who are making such a great sacrifice.
It really takes a village. You know, we can't do it without leadership and without support. And you both have served on boards and provided leadership and provided support. And it takes all of us to be able to do it. And I just love that you have found, you know, so many ways to support the arts, not just for us, the Chance, but arts throughout Southern California. So it's pretty remarkable.
Thank you.
And we couldn't do without you.
Very nice.
A chance encounter is a fortuitous accident. So we end on all of our interviews with this question. What unexpected experience have you had recently that's having a lasting impact on you?
Probably I feel that I have a lot of wonderful things that I've done in my lifetime, and I probably would never want to replace any one of them.
I rediscovered
home. I sometimes work too hard. And so I realized when I was working remote, I was seeing things in this yard, seeing things in the kitchen, seeing things throughout where we lived, and things I had just taken for granted. And so every little thing, like where I'm standing here right now, and the beauty of what Betty's done with the yard, and that I would have blown off, not paid any attention to, I just discovered what it's like to focus exclusively on home and family, and that's been a really enriching experience.
We end each episode with a performance of a classic monologue. It hasn't always worked out, but this time we are getting it right. New season, new me. Here, without interruption, is a performance of a classic monologue.
Oh, the world's a stage. And all the men and women.
Sir, do you have a moment to talk about your car's limited warranty?
Yes. Yes, I do.
Here's our ghost light. A bare bulb. A light in the darkness, even when no one is there. So while the Chance Theater prepares for your return, we hope, in some small way, we can be that light for you. Until then, bye for now. And don't forget, we have plans to meet later. But let's hope before then for a chance encounter.
Excuse me. Can you actually put that back? We're going to start working in here.
James, can we please get out of your bathroom now?
What's the difference between a beat and a pause? That's it.